Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. The Monetary Policy Committee has decided to cut the benchmark interest rate by 25 basis points, that is by 0.25%. This decision has been taken in order to pump more liquidity into the market and increase commercial lending by banks so that the slowdown in the economy can be revived. This is the fifth consecutive rate cut that has been announced by the RBI. And it shows that the Monetary Policy Committee and the RBI are continuing to adopt an accommodative stance when it comes to promoting growth at the risk of increasing inflation. So in this context, let us talk about the benchmark interest rate, the Monetary Policy Committee, and the conflict between growth and inflation in detail. See, the benchmark interest rate is nothing but the repo rate. Repo stands for repurchase rate, and it is the interest rate at which central bank of a country lends money to the commercial banks. The repo rate is considered as a monetary policy tool that is available to the RBI in order to control inflation and liquidity in the market. So by increasing or decreasing the repo rate, the RBI can determine as to how much liquidity will be available in the market. This in turn will determine whether the RBI is looking to control inflation or if it is looking to promote economic growth. See, the primary objective of the central bank is to manage liquidity in the market and to strike a balance between the conflicting demands of controlling inflation and promoting economic growth. High inflation is an outcome of a major mismatch between demand and supply. Inflationary tendencies develops in the market when the demand is very high and when the supply side is not able to catch up with this demand. And the reason for high demand is more liquidity or more money in the hands of the people. So if inflation has to be controlled from the demand side, then the option available for the RBI is to suck out liquidity from the market. Then on the other hand, if supply has to be increased, then the RBI has to promote economic growth through new investments. So if investments have to increase, then the investors need to have more money in their hands. This would mean that the investors should be able to borrow easily from the commercial banks at lower interest rates. And if the commercial banks have to lend money easily to the investors at low interest rates, then they need to have more liquidity. So this would mean that the RBI has to pump more liquidity into the market so that economic growth can be promoted. So as you can see, liquidity management is a risky affair. If there is excess liquidity in the market, it can promote growth in the short term, but in the long run, it might lead to inflation. And the vice versa also holds true. So the RBI manages liquidity by using the benchmark interest rate known as the repo rate. So if the RBI increases the repo rate, then it means that the RBI is looking to control inflation even at the risk of compromising economic growth. Similarly, if the repo rate is decreased, it means that the RBI has adopted an accommodative stance and it is looking to promote growth even at the risk of promoting inflation. So over the last 5 months, the RBI has consistently adopted an accommodative stance by keeping in mind the slowdown in the Indian economy. It has consistently reduced the repo rate in order to increase liquidity in the markets so that economic growth can be revived. But the markets are not happy with the rate cut that has been announced by the Monetary Policy Committee because they were expecting higher rate cuts considering the economic crisis that India is going through. The economic slowdown is evident from the fact that the RBI has revised its GDP forecast for the current financial year from 6.9% to 6.1%. But the markets were expecting a higher rate cut because it feels that a reduction of 0.25% in the repo rate won't be sufficient to revive economic growth. Now let us talk about the Monetary Policy Committee. See, the Monetary Policy Committee is the nodal authority for fixing the repo rate or the benchmark interest rate. This committee was set up in 2016 in order to bring greater transparency and accountability in India's monetary policy. See, prior to 2016, the repo rate was being fixed by the RBI alone. The RBI had complete autonomy when it came to managing India's monetary policy. And when I say RBI, it refers to the governor of the RBI because he had complete powers to fix the monetary policy and the repo rate before 2016. But this previous arrangement would always result in a conflict between the governor of the RBI and the government of India, because the government would like to revive growth even at the cost of risking inflation, whereas the governor and the RBI would be more focused on controlling inflation even at the risk of compromising economic growth. Earlier, with regard to determining the monetary policy, the governor of the RBI enjoyed discretionary powers and he was neither bound by the advice of the Ministry of Finance nor by the advice provided by the Technical Advisory Committee of the RBI. So this was always resulting in a conflict between the government and the governor of the RBI. And in order to resolve this conflict, the Monetary Policy Committee was established in 2016. And this has brought greater transparency and accountability in India's monetary policy. Right now, the monetary policy and the benchmark interest rate is determined not just by the governor of the RBI, but by the six members who are a part of the Monetary Policy Committee. So from 2016 onwards, the repo rate is being determined by the Monetary Policy Committee, which comprises of six members. This includes three officials of the Reserve Bank of India, including the governor, and there are three external members who are nominated by the Government of India. The governor of the RBI functions as the ex officio chairperson of the committee, and the committee will meet at least four times in a year, that is at least once in each quarter. The decisions of the Monetary Policy Committee are taken by a majority vote, and in case of a tie, it is the governor who enjoys the casting vote. And right now, all the members of the committee are required to justify their decisions by providing a written explanation. This is what has introduced greater transparency and accountability in India's monetary policy. And also please note down that the committee has been given the mandate to maintain an annual inflation rate of around 4% until 31st March 2021 with a tolerance range of 2% to 6%. Next, on page number 10, we have an editorial which is related to the same topic. The editorial says that the RBI has done enough with its monetary policy in order to promote economic growth. But at the end of the day, the monetary policy has its own limits with regard to promoting growth. So as a result, the responsibility lies with the government to revive investment and growth by using its fiscal policy. See, the slowdown in the Indian economy is very evident from the fact that growth in the first quarter was just 5%, which is one of the lowest in the last few years. As we discussed earlier, the RBI has revised its GDP forecast for this financial year from 6.9% to 6.1%. So these are clear indications that there is a massive slowdown in investments and economic growth, and hence the RBI has made use of the monetary policy over the last 5 to 6 months in order to revive investments. It has already reduced the repo rate by 135 basis points, that is by 1.35%. But at the end of the day, there are certain limits to what the monetary policy can achieve, and there are limits to what the RBI can do. So now, the ball is in the government's court to promote investments and growth by coming out with a prudent fiscal policy. See, luckily for the government, the inflation is well under control, even though the repo rate has been reduced by 135 basis points. And even the global crude oil prices have stabilized over the last few months. And even the food prices in the domestic market are stable thanks to a good monsoon season. So most of the other factors are going in favor of the government. So this is the right time for the government to come out with a fiscal stimulus and ensure that investments are revived. But to be fair, the government has tried to introduce a number of fiscal reforms over the last few months. For example, the government announced massive tax cuts for the corporate sector. So this measure is expected to leave more money in the hands of the corporates who can use it to make fresh investments. So more such fiscal policy measures are needed in order to stimulate growth. But the downside of this policy is that the government will run the risk of overshooting its fiscal deficit targets. So the editorial says that if the government is serious about reviving consumption and demand, then it needs to strike a balance between providing the right kind of fiscal stimulus and fulfilling its fiscal deficit targets. Now let's take up the next article. 49 celebrities, including intellectuals and social activists, have been booked for sedition just for the act of writing an open letter to the Prime Minister in order to raise concern about the increasing incidents of mob lynchings. See, in simple words, sedition basically means anti-national activity. It includes any act which promotes hatred and disaffection against the state. It includes any act which challenges the authority of the state. And all such acts are labeled as seditious activities or anti-national activities. This could basically include the simple act of writing a letter or delivering a speech or possessing any literature. In the case of India, sedition has been defined under Section 124A of the Indian Penal Code. This is a highly controversial provision which was introduced by the colonial government in order to clamp down on the freedom struggle. Freedom fighters such as Mahatma Gandhi, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Nehru, etc., they have all been charged for sedition under Section 124A of the Indian Penal Code. Unfortunately, this provision has been carried forward into post-independent India as well, and hence the provision is usually referred to as a controversial piece of legislation or a draconian law. The problem with Section 124A is that it provides for a very wide definition of seditious activities and it provides tremendous discretionary powers to the government. And such a provision can be easily misused by the government in order to stifle dissent and opposition. Unfortunately, India is one of the few democratic countries that have such draconian laws in place. The biggest concern about this provision is that it can be easily misused to stifle our fundamental right of freedom of expression, which is guaranteed under Article 19 of the Indian Constitution. But in this particular case, it is not the government of India which has violated the freedom of expression of these 49 celebrities, but unfortunately, they have been booked under the charges of sedition based on the orders of a chief judicial magistrate. Based on a petition filed by an advocate, the chief judicial magistrate has deemed that the open letter written by these 49 celebrities to the Prime Minister was seditious in nature and it had caused public nuisance and hurt religious sentiments. But if you look at the contents of the letter, the celebrities were only voicing their concern about the increasing cases of mob lynchings in the name of religion. The list of celebrities includes eminent personalities such as historian Ramchandra Guha, Aparna Sen, Mani Ratnam, Adur Gopalkrishnan, etc. These celebrities were requesting the Prime Minister to take strict action against the perpetrators of these incidents. They have also claimed that they were not holding the government responsible for these incidents and they were only demanding that the government should act against them. So it is quite clear that there is no way that the writing of the letter can be classified as an anti-national activity. They were clearly exercising their fundamental right in order to express their concern against these incidents. So it is highly unfortunate that the judiciary has charged them with sedition and it shows the potential for Section 124A of the IPC to be misused. Now let's take up the next article. US lawmakers have taken a step against India with regard to the prevailing humanitarian crisis in Kashmir. The United States Senate Committee on Foreign Relations has labeled the current situation in Kashmir as a humanitarian crisis. It has called upon the Indian government to immediately end the communication lockdown and restore the internet services. It has demanded that India should immediately lift the curfew and release all the politicians who have been detained. This is the first major condemnation of India by the lawmakers of a powerful country after India revoked the special status of Jammu and Kashmir under Article 370. See, as of now, India has managed to convince the governments of major countries such as the United States, United Kingdom, France, Russia, and a few Middle Eastern governments as well that decisions related to Article 370 are an internal matter of India. These governments seem to have accepted the position of the Indian government. But India needs to remember that even though the global community has accepted this position of the Indian government, they will continue to watch the developments in Kashmir very closely. Even though India has managed to convince the governments of these countries, it would be extremely difficult to convince the lawmakers of these countries. So if India doesn't lift the communication lockdown and the curfews, and if it allows the humanitarian crisis to persist, then it can be rest assured that global pressure and international pressure will continue to grow on the Indian government. For the time being, the governments of the friendly countries may not act against India, but their lawmakers, they might start taking a stand against the Indian government, and this will further exert diplomatic pressure on India. Now let's take up the next article. India's first e-waste clinic to come up in Bhopal. The Bhopal Municipal Corporation is joining hands with the Central Pollution Control Board to set up the first e-waste clinic of India. This e-waste management facility will be set up in accordance with the Solid Waste Management Rules of 2016 and the e-waste management rules that have been laid down by the Ministry of Environment and Forest. It will provide for end-to-end scientific management of electronic waste, which will cover all the phases including collection, segregation, processing and disposal. Now let's take up the next article. The government of Mizoram has rejected the proposed amendments to the Indian Forest Act. See, the government of India has proposed a few controversial amendments to the Indian Forest Act of 1927. But these amendments have been rejected by the government of Mizoram because the proposed amendments goes against the special protection that the state enjoys under Article 371G of the Indian Constitution and the special rights that have been recognized under the Forest Rights Act of 2006. See, Mizoram has been recognized as a predominantly tribal state under the 6th schedule of the Indian Constitution, and it provides for the establishment of autonomous district councils. To further protect this autonomy, Article 371G has been added to the Indian Constitution, wherein central laws cannot be automatically extended to Mizoram. If central legislation has to be extended into the state, then it has to be approved by the state government and as well as by the autonomous district councils. A state which enjoys special protection under the Indian Constitution has been empowered to reject the extension of the central laws in certain cases. If the state government feels that the central law would violate the religion and the culture of the tribal communities, then the extension of the central law can be rejected. Similarly, if the state government feels that the central law could violate the customary laws and practices dealing with transfer of land and ownership of the tribal communities are being violated, then the state government can reject the extension of the central law. So similar concerns have been expressed by the state government of Mizoram with regard to the proposed amendments to the Indian Forest Act of 1927. Because see, under the Forest Rights Act of 2006, the tribal communities have been given the dwelling rights, the land title rights, and they also enjoy rights over the forest produce. Then under the Forest Rights Act, the tribal communities play a key role in the management of the forest resources through the Gram Sabhas. The Gram Sabhas have been given decision-making powers under the Forest Rights Act, and they have been empowered to manage the forest resources. But the amendments proposed by the Centre to the Indian Forest Act could take away these rights which have been protected by the Forest Rights Act. The tribal communities in Mizoram feel that if these proposed amendments are implemented, then it could result in the eviction of the forest dwelling communities. It will give a role for the forest bureaucracy to decide upon the management of forest resources, and it will promote the private exploitation of forest resources. So due to these concerns that have been expressed by the stakeholders, the government of Mizoram has cited its special protection under Article 371G, and it has used this as a ground to reject the proposed amendments to the Indian Forest Act. Now let's take up the next article. The center has approved the release of 1,200 crore rupees for Karnataka and 400 crore rupees for Bihar from the National Disaster Response Fund in order to supplement the respective state disaster response funds. See, the NDRF and the SDRF have been established by the Disaster Management Act of 2005, and they are a part of the public account of the center and the state respectively. So accordingly, a National Disaster Response Fund has been set up and it is managed by the center. And a State Disaster Response Fund has been set up in each state and it is managed by the respective state governments. And according to the Disaster Management Act, these funds can be used only for providing immediate relief in the aftermath of a disaster. This means that the funds can be used only for providing immediate relief such as search and rescue, first aid, basic essentials, etc. So these funds cannot be used for providing compensation for the losses that have been incurred by the people during a disaster. Next, we need to talk about the financing of the state disaster response funds. See, the SDRF has been set up through the joint contribution of the center and the respective state governments. With regard to general category states, the financing ratio is 75:25. It means that the center will provide 75% of the funds for a general category state and the remaining has to be organized by the state government itself. Whereas the financing ratio changes to 90:10 in the case of special category states. So when a disaster occurs, a state government is expected to use the funds from the State Disaster Response Fund in order to provide for immediate relief. But if the funds in the SDRF are not sufficient, and if the state government is not able to finance the immediate relief operations, then the state government can request for additional supplementary assistance from the NDRF. So if such a request for additional supplementary assistance has been received from a state government, then the center carries out an assessment of the damage that has been caused by the disaster and it decides to release additional funds in order to supplement the resources of the SDRF. So kindly remember that in the aftermath of a disaster, the immediate relief operations are always sponsored by the SDRF. Only when SDRF funds are falling short, only then additional assistance can be requested and the SDRF can be supplemented by funding from the NDRF. Now let's take up a column from the editorial page. The column has been written by M.K. Narayanan, who was India's former national security advisor, and it deals with the upcoming India-China summit at Mamallapuram or Mahabalipuram. See, India has chosen Mamallapuram as the venue for this informal summit as a symbolic gesture. The coastal town of Mamallapuram near Chennai represents a historical connection between India and China, and it is an extension of India's soft power. Back in the 8th century, Mamallapuram was under the rule of the Pallava dynasty. The then Pallava king, Rajasimhan or Narasimha Varma II, had signed a security deal with the then Chinese Empire. Under this security pact, the then Chinese Empire had sought the help of the Pallava dynasty to counter the threat posed by the Tibetan Empire to China. So India has chosen Mamallapuram as the venue for this informal summit as a symbolic gesture to the historical and civilizational ties between India and China. This upcoming informal summit is expected to be a follow-up to the Wuhan informal summit, which took place in April 2018. The informal summit at Wuhan took place in 2018 in the backdrop of the Doklam crisis, which had brought India and China to the brink of conflict. The Wuhan summit had played a key role in diffusing the tensions between the two countries during the Doklam crisis, and both the leaders had agreed to frequently hold such high-level strategic talks. So the upcoming summit at Mamallapuram is a follow-up informal summit to the Wuhan summit of 2018. So in this context, the writer is asking India to carry forward the spirit of Wuhan and ensure that India doesn't unnecessarily provoke China, which might lead to a further increase in tensions between the two countries. The writer is asking the Indian government to take into account the geopolitical and economic changes that have taken place since the Wuhan summit. See, since the Wuhan summit, China has been going through a major economic slowdown. Its trade wars and geopolitical rivalry with the United States has increased, and opposition to its ambitious Belt and Road initiative has also increased. So naturally, these developments would have made China defensive, and India needs to ensure that it doesn't exploit these opportunities and provoke China unnecessarily. Because unlike China, India's geopolitical position has strengthened since the Wuhan summit. India's relations has improved significantly with the United States. India is playing a key role in the proposed quadrilateral grouping, which will have major implications for the geopolitics of the Indo-Pacific. Plus, India has made a major outreach to the Russian Far East region as well. Obviously, these developments would have been closely watched by China, and this could further increase the conflicts and the contradictions between the two sides. Apart from the geopolitical and economic decline that China has witnessed since the Wuhan summit, China has also seen a significant increase in its internal security challenges. China has noted that unrest in Tibet has increased, the extremist activities of Uyghur terror groups has increased in the Xinjiang province, and also the protests in Hong Kong have intensified. So naturally, China would be extremely wary of these internal and external developments, and India needs to ensure that it is not seen in the same bracket as that of the United States. India needs to ensure that it is pursuing an independent foreign policy, and it is not merely acting at the behest of the United States. Because China holds a lot of suspicion with regard to India's involvement with the US, Japan, Australia, etc. And China also sees India's increased military activities along the Indo-China border with a lot of suspicion. Of course, India also holds similar suspicions against China, mainly because of its involvement with Pakistan, its Belt and Road initiative, and the proposed alignment of the China-Pakistan economic corridor. Plus, India is extremely concerned about the aggression that China displays with regard to border disputes and the maritime disputes in the South China Sea. So, in the context of all these developments, it is very important for India and as well as for China to not provoke each other unnecessarily and build upon the Wuhan spirit and ensure that the Mamallapuram summit will be a success. India needs to remember that China has always believed in the principles developed by Sun Tzu, which have been enshrined in his treatise, The Art of War. Sun Tzu had developed a strategic doctrine which advocated that an enemy should be subdued without fighting. And this doctrine has become the central pillar of Chinese strategic thinking. So the writer says that India needs to adequately prepare for the upcoming summit by looking at the principles that govern Chinese strategic thinking. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following committees had recommended the establishment of the Monetary Policy Committee? Was it the YV Reddy Committee, or the Tarapore Committee, or the Percy Mistry Committee, the Raghuram Rajan Committee, or the Urjit Patel Committee? The correct answer is option D. All the five committees had recommended the establishment of the Monetary Policy Committee. Now let's take up the second question. Which of the following statements are correct? The Spider missile is a short and medium range mobile air defense system. It has been developed by France. The first statement is correct. The second statement is wrong, because the Spider missile has been developed by Israel. So the first statement is right. Option A is the correct answer. Now let us take up the third question. The sedition law in India was originally drafted by Thomas Macaulay. Option C is the right answer. Now let us take up a map-based question. Which of the following statements are correct? The Balochistan province of Pakistan shares a border with Iran only. This is a wrong statement. The strategic port of Gwadar is located in Balochistan. This is a correct statement. So option B is the right answer. Now let us take up a practice question from the 2019 prelims paper. The ninth schedule was introduced in the constitution during the prime ministership of Jawaharlal Nehru. Option A is the right answer. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, inflation management and promotion of growth are conflicting objectives. Elaborate how the RBI manages these contradictory demands. The second question, what precautions should India take ahead of the Mamallapuram informal summit with China? So kindly write an answer to these questions and post them in the comment section below. This concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.